shines brighter. Jesus shines pure and reigns to all the world His love. Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, He makes the soaring spirit sing.
Good morning and God bless you. Welcome to the house of the Lord, at least digitally this morning. I'm Captain Keith Maynard, one of the officers at the Camden Croc Center, and it's my privilege to welcome you and to bless you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. This Sunday is our last, hopefully God willing, our last Sunday together meeting on this digital platform, on whether you're watching on Facebook or YouTube. Next Sunday, which is February 13th, we are meeting back together in person for worship together. But a couple things just to announce as we're going to be transitioning back into live worship. We are going to be extra critical and extra harsh on our social distancing. Everyone's going to have to come to the chapel in mask, and we're going to really enforce the 6 foot distance policies as described and prescribed by the CDC. So thank you for joining with us this morning, and we really hope to see as many as possible back next Sunday. This morning, we're going to be hearing the word from the Lord from Captain Brennan Heinzman. He'll be reading from the passage of Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 through 6. Before we get into the worship and hear from the word, I'd like to introduce you to our new core mission specialist. Mr. Aaron Mays is basically at the Croc for about a week, and we're so thrilled and excited that he's here to make a big impact for the kingdom. And if you come next Sunday, hopefully you'll get the chance to meet him and his beautiful and lovely family. So God bless you, and keep well and keep safe.
Good morning. My name is Aaron Mains, and I am the new core mission specialist at the Salvation Army Croc Center in Camden. I am so happy to be in this position. I'm so excited. It is the Lord's favor upon my life. I wanted to share with you briefly from Psalm 27, and then I wanted to open us in prayer. So I've selected one verse, and it's Psalm 27, verse 4. The word of the Lord reads, "One thing I have desired of the Lord that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple." Family and friends, I am so excited to be with you in the house of the Lord. That's a great thing. But what I want to share with you, my heart is more excited about my body, the temple, and us as the church corporately being the house of the Lord where His Spirit dwells. And I'm so excited to meet you, Lord willing, this Sunday. I'll be introducing my family, my lovely wife, Stephanie, and I have three daughters, Annabelle, Elise, and Evangeline. Would you pray with me? Father, I thank you so much, Lord, that we have the forgiveness of sins through your Son's death on the cross. Lord, you've given us the Holy Spirit, God, and we ask that your Spirit would move among us. Lord, you would touch every heart today, whether it be through YouTube or Facebook, in people's living rooms, if they're driving, wherever they are, Lord, touch their hearts. Let them know that they have been with the Lord. And we look forward to gathering together in person and the work that you do by your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in
your mind. Good morning, friends. It's so good to be with you, at least virtually. This morning, we pray that you're doing well and staying safe during these times. And at this time, we're going to invite the kids to maybe pay attention a little more as we do our kids' five. But adults, you can pay attention too. So I have my helpers here again with me this week.
Zoe.
And Charlotte, two of our girls, and they're going to help me with the kids' five today. So, who can tell me what this is? Yes, Zoe?
A Ziploc bag.
A Ziploc bag. And what's in the Ziploc bag?
Water.
Water. Now, here's a big question for you guys. Are you ready? Do you trust me? What? Why was there hesitation? Do you guys trust me?
Yes. Mom, can we go on a plane?
Do you trust mommy?
Yes.
Yeah, that didn't sound too convincing. Do you trust that I won't get you wet with this bag of water?
Yes.
What if I put it over your head?
No.
No? No. You don't trust me?
No.
All right, Zoe, trust me? What if I told you
that
I'm going to poke my pencil through this bag over your head and not get you wet? Do you still trust me?
Yes.
You don't trust mommy?
Just me.
How about I don't do it over her head, just at the table, okay?
Yeah. You do it over my head. Mom, no. Do it over my head.
Okay, no. So Charlotte doesn't have faith. That's right. Zoe, you have faith in me? You think I could put this through and it knock water all over the place?
Plate.
Okay, are we ready to count?
Yeah. Plate.
Let's just count down from three. Head. Ready? Three.
Two.
One. Ready? Wait, No. This is mommy's example here. Ready? Charlotte, look. Is there any water out? Pretty awesome. Now.
Not another. Over my head.
Do you think I could do another one?
No.
No?
Yes. Yes.
You think
it's over my head.
Over your head?
No. It's fine.
Close your eyes.
Don't do it. No.
Charlotte. It's okay. Okay, I won't do it over her head. I'm sorry.
No.
This is just like how a kid's five would be in church, friends. So you're getting the full effect here. Ready?
Told you.
Look.
Yeah.
I should have done it over your head.
No.
Did you get wet? Did the table get wet?
No, not even.
No, right? It seems impossible that this could happen, right?
Except if you take it out.
Huh?
Except if you take it out.
Yeah, if I take it out, it's going to go all right. Trusting me in this moment doesn't make a lot of sense, right? Like Charlotte didn't really trust me. It didn't really make sense to her. And yet here we are with a bag full of water and holes without any water pouring out, right?
Mm-hmm.
No water pouring out. I'm not even lying, right? There's nothing there. Sometimes, hold on. Sometimes it's hard to trust God, right?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like it might have been a little hard to trust that I wasn't going to spill the water all over you. But you know what? We can trust God even when it doesn't make sense or even when it might seem a little scary. God loves us and cares for us. And his word reminds us to put all of our trust in him. Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight." Isn't that a beautiful reminder to us all?
Yes.
Yes, Zoe?
I've watched a science video of this.
You've watched a science video of this? Yes, there is some science behind this, but I am in no way a scientist, so I can't tell you the ins and outs of it, but basically the molecules in the bag form around the pencil so that they don't let the water out. I honestly didn't believe it when I saw it, but I tried it for myself and it works. So maybe if you're at home and you have a Ziploc bag and some pencils lying around, you could try it too, if your mom and dad let you. And you could probably use pens too, something pointy. Anyway, so the reminder in our scripture is to trust in the Lord with all of our heart, right? And the next part says to lean not on our own understanding, right? It's not all about what we think is best, but we trust that the Lord knows what's best for us, right? And that he will make our path straight. He will guide and direct us, okay? So we're going to pray. I'm going to put this down and hope that it doesn't explode.
No.
Oh, we're good. Wow. Okay, reach your hands up to the ceiling and wiggle your fingers and snap them together and lower them down and bow your head and close your eyes and we're going to repeat after me, okay? Dear Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your word.
Thank you for your
promises.
Thank you for your promises.
And we thank you.
And we thank you.
That we can put all of our trust in you.
That we can put all your trust in you.
Help us.
Help us.
To trust you.
To trust you.
And to put you first.
And to put you first.
We love you.
We love you.
And it's in Jesus' name.
It's Jesus' name.
That we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks for joining us for our Kids 5, and we'll see you next week. God bless.
Again.
water still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. Still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me again. And you've never failed me yet. I never will forget. You never failed me yet. I never will forget.
This morning's passage is taken from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And the sermon title is, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understandings. But in all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight." As a parent, one of the most important things for me is that my children trust me. When I tell my daughters it's safe to eat a piece of candy, to cross the street, or not to touch the stove, I want them to know that what I'm saying is important, that they can and that they need to trust what I'm saying. And it's because I love them and I have their best interest at heart. Our scripture today, as read already, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart." Now these verses are one of those verses that seem easy to say oftentimes. It makes us feel positive, encouraged, strong, like we can handle anything. But when life becomes difficult, when pain comes in, stress, frustration, when things don't seem to be going the way that we had hoped they would go, sometimes it becomes difficult to believe this. There's a man I want to talk about today, a man who was and is very well respected in the church and in the eyes of God. But a man who struggled trusting Jesus when things got a little rocky. Peter. He is one of the original 12 disciples of Jesus. He's known for his boldness all throughout Scripture. He was a man who desired to learn from Jesus and teach like Jesus did. He was one of the first that Jesus called to follow him. While Peter was out fishing, because that's what he did for a living, Jesus called him to come and follow him. Peter left everything behind to follow this man that he wholeheartedly believed in. But there came a couple times when Peter wasn't so sure about everything, when he allowed the what-ifs of life to kind of creep in. Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 through 31 says this, "Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. 'It's a ghost!' they shouted and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said, 'Take courage, it's I. Don't be afraid.' 'Lord, if it's you,' Peter replied, 'tell me to come to you on the water.' 'Come,' he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, 'Lord, save me.' Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. 'You of little faith,' he said, 'why did you doubt?'" You see, when the waves began crashing, the wind began to blow harder, Peter got distracted. He was reminded of the what-ifs of life. What if the waves knock me over? What if the wind knocks me out of the way? What if I fall into the water? What if I die in this moment? What if I'm just not ready for all of this? Because of these what ifs, Peter took his eyes off of Jesus. He realized that he was no longer in control. He didn't know what was going to happen next, and because of this, he was filled with fear, worry, stress, and anxiety. It crippled him. Crying out to Jesus, Jesus saves him and asks, "Why did you doubt?" Later, Peter faces another what if moment. Jumping on to Matthew chapter 26, verses 31 through 35, Jesus is now preparing for his death. Knowing what's to come, he requests the disciples to come together with him for what's known as the Last Supper. He takes this opportunity to make them aware of the things that are about to happen. Verse 31 says, "Then Jesus told them, 'This very night you will all fall away on account of me, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee.' Peter replied, 'Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will.' 'Truly I tell you,' Jesus answered, 'this very night, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times.' But Peter declared, 'Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you.'" Now, I believe much like Peter's last situation we discussed, Peter thought he would never doubt Christ. He thought that he knew everything he needed to know. He was fully prepared. He was ready. He wholeheartedly believed that he was strong enough for what was to come. He wouldn't accept, however, Jesus' words here. As he quickly responded, "Jesus, I would never." That is until something happened that yet again brought on the what ifs of life. Verse 47 says, "While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priest and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. 'The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him.' Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, 'Greetings, Rabbi,' and kissed him. And Jesus replied, 'Do what you came for, friend.'" You see, it was at this moment that Peter was faced yet again with a what if. He believed that he was ready for whatever was going to happen, but because things were well, he believed this. Because Jesus had always been with him throughout everything he had faced so far, he believed this. Because he had seen Jesus teaching and healing, and although things were still rough, Jesus was always right there with him. But now, if what Jesus was saying all along was now going to come true, things were about to be very different. This time, the what ifs were stronger than ever before. What if Jesus dies and leaves me all alone? What if I can't preach or teach like he wants me to? What if people find out who I am? What if they come after me next? It's easy for us, much like Peter, to fall into this what-if phase. Serving God, we never really know what's coming next in life. But the danger in this what-if phase is that so long as we are there, we will never fully experience the love and power of Jesus Christ. All because we're leaning on our own understanding. I wonder if you can relate to this today. It seems so easy to say, trust in the Lord with all your heart. But when things begin to get rough again, when money is tight and you're not sure how things are going to work out, when we lose a loved one, when someone that we know becomes very sickly, when we can't provide for our families the way that we want to, when the numbers of this virus continue to rise day in and day out, it starts to become harder and harder for us to trust in Jesus. In 1875, Louisa Stead married and gave birth to her daughter, Lily. When their daughter was only 4 years old, the family decided to take a vacation on the shores of Long Island. One day during their vacation, they decided to go to the beach and have a picnic. They woke up early, packed their bag and blanket, and made their way toward the water. While they were there enjoying their time together as a family, Mr. Stead heard the cries of a young boy in the water. He ran to the waterside to look for the boy, and when he saw him drowning in the distance, he immediately began to swim to his rescue. Louisa and Lily watched from the shore. They watched helplessly as their beloved husband and father drowned while attempting to rescue that little boy. With no way to financially support themselves after Mr. Stead's death, Louisa and Lily were now left in poverty. It was in that moment, through that personal tragedy, that the words of the classic hymn were penned. "'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him as his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more." Today there are a lot of things going on. I wonder, do we trust him? Do we trust him when he says in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Trust me, all of you who have been trying to go through life on your own. All of you who are tired of the fight, tired of the stress, frustration, tired of facing everything on your own and in your own strength. Come to me, and I will give you rest. Let me take your load off." Do we trust him when he says in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Today, do we trust that his plan is perfect? Do we trust that it's not a plan to harm us, but to give us hope and a future? I pray this morning that we will learn maybe for the first time, or that we will be reminded this morning how important and necessary it is that we trust in Jesus, in the big things and the small things. I pray we will trust that his plan is perfect. Will you pray with me? Our Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to read, Lord, and to discuss and to learn from you. And God, this morning, I pray that we will be a people who trust in you. Lord, when things again seem to be falling apart and people don't quite know what's happening next or where to go or where to turn, Father, when we're worried for our jobs or we're worried for our families, Lord, I pray that we will rely on you, that we will lean on your understanding and not ours. This morning, God, I pray that we will rely on you, that we will trust your words. We thank you for your love today and for never leaving us. And it's in your name we pray.